Imagine their discovery, so revolutionary it could rewrite the rules of physics and redefine how we think about energy. In 1989, Fleischmann and Pons announced just that, an experiment claiming to have achieved cold fusion, nuclear energy without the extreme temperatures of the sun. Their announcement sparked worldwide intrigue, followed quickly by skepticism and outright dismissal. Yet decades later, the phenomenon they described, known as low-energy nuclear reactions, refuses to fade into obscurity. Hundreds of experiments continue to report anomalous results, suggesting something remarkable is happening, even if mainstream science struggles to explain it. What if LENR isn't just an anomaly, but a key to unlocking new nuclear processes? From bizarre isotopic changes to unexpected energy releases, LENR defies traditional classification of fusion and fission. It challenges the very foundations of nuclear physics and opens the door to a world of possibilities, if we are willing to step through. In this video, we will dive into the evolution of the LENR field after Fleischmann and Pons' controversial claims, exploring the diverse mechanisms proposed to explain these mysterious reactions. Could the solution to LENR's puzzle be hiding in plain sight, requiring only a shift of perspective? Stay with us as we uncover the cutting-edge ideas shaping the future of nuclear science, and perhaps the way we think about the universe itself. Over two decades since Fleischmann and Pons first introduced the controversial concept of cold fusion, the phenomenon continues to challenge conventional understandings. Low-energy nuclear reactions present two remarkable behaviours. It produces significant energy and nuclear byproducts in environments where such reactions should not occur, and it does so without emitting energetic radiation typically associated with nuclear processes. When radiation is observed, it is usually low in energy and intensity. Despite early skepticism, these findings have been replicated by hundreds of experiments across various methods and materials, pointing to the reality of nuclear reactions occurring in solids without requiring the high energy inputs characteristic of traditional nuclear fusion. The rejection of Fleischmann and Pons' claims largely stems from two prevailing beliefs. Nuclear fusion cannot occur in ordinary materials without significant energy input, and the byproducts of fusion, such as high energy particles, are conspicuously absent. However, the inability of many laboratories to replicate their results under similar conditions led to widespread criticism. This, combined with theoretical challenges to the plausibility of cold fusion, caused the field to fall into disrepute. Despite this setback, a determined group of researchers continue to investigate, refining experimental techniques and broadening the scope of inquiry, eventually leading to the rebranding of the field as low-energy nuclear reactions. In the aftermath of Fleischmann and Pons' controversial announcement, researchers diverged along several paths, each seeking to uncover mechanisms behind the observed phenomena. Some scientists focused on reproducing the original palladium-deuterium electrolyte experiments, refining experimental setups to improve reliability. This approach yielded occasional success, with evidence of excess heat and helium production under specific conditions, suggesting that the phenomenon was real but highly sensitive to experimental parameters. Other researchers began exploring alternative materials and methods. Nickel hydrogen systems gained attention, particularly after the work of Piantelli and Rossi, who reported excess heat in gas phase LENR systems. These systems differed significantly from Fleischmann and Pons' original setup, as they utilized metal hydrides and higher temperatures, pointing to the possibility that LENR might occur in a variety of environments and materials beyond palladium and deuterium. The quest to understand LENR also led to the exploration of non-traditional setups, such as gas-loading experiments, plasma-based methods, and even sonofusion, where sound waves are used to induce cavitation and potential nuclear reactions. Each of these approaches revealed unique aspects of LENR, with some experiments producing unexpected nuclear byproducts, such as transmuted elements and isotopes, which were difficult to explain through conventional theories. Additionally, some researchers pursued more theoretical avenues, developing models that incorporated novel physics, such as quantum effects, ultra-low momentum neutrons, and the structured atom model, or resonance processes within highly localized environments. These theories aim to address why LENR reactions appear to defy traditional expectations, such as the requirement for high energy input or the emission of detectable radiation. As the field matured, researchers adopted the term LENR to distinguish their work from the stigma surrounding cold fusion. This rebranding reflected a broader understanding of the phenomenon, emphasizing that LENR encompasses a range of nuclear processes beyond simple fusion. The diversity of experimental results, ranging from heat production to isotopic shifts and even fission-like products, demonstrated that LENR was not a single well-defined process, but rather a collection of related phenomena occurring under specific conditions. This period of diversification also highlighted the challenges facing the field. The wide range of experimental setups, materials, and observed outputs made it difficult to establish a unified theory. Moreover, the lack of reproducibility in many experiments hindered acceptance by the broader scientific community. Nevertheless, the persistence of anomalous results across decades of research ensured that LENR remained an area of active investigation, with potential implications for energy generation, transmutation, and even nuclear waste remediation. The transition from cold fusion to LENR marked a pivotal shift in the field, expanding its scope and attracting researchers from diverse disciplines. One of the significant challenges in understanding LENR is the wide variety of nuclear products that are observed, many of which do not fit the expected pattern of traditional fusion. In fusion experiments, especially those involving hydrogen isotopes like deuterium, one would expect to see the production of primarily helium and possibly neutrons as a result of the fusion of lighter nuclei. However, in numerous LENR experiments, heavier elements such as copper, titanium, iron, and even barium and strontium, elements typically associated with fission products, are detected. These results challenge the conventional assumption that fusion is the only process occurring in these experiments, as fusion is generally understood to produce lighter elements like helium, not the wide variety of heavier elements observed. Despite the reoccurring detection of these unexpected nuclear products, many researchers remain biased towards the belief that fusion is the only possible explanation for what is happening in LENR systems. This confirmation bias often leads to the dismissal of alternative explanations, such as the fusion of larger atoms or fission-like reactions, and can cause researchers to overlook or downplay relevant data. For instance, when fission-like products like copper or titanium are detected, the immediate assumption is that these elements must be the result of contamination, rather than a part of the nuclear process itself. This is particularly problematic because isotopic shifts where certain isotopes of elements, like copper or titanium, increase while others decrease, suggest that nuclear reactions are occurring, and that isotopic transmutation is taking place, not contamination. This neglect of alternative interpretations is evident in many LENR studies, where consistent patterns of unusual isotopic changes are attributed to external contamination, rather than acknowledging that the experiment might be producing fission-like nuclear reactions or transmutations. Time and time again, the same elements, such as vanadium, titanium, copper, and iron, show up in these experiments, often in altered isotopic forms that are difficult to explain by contamination alone. The repetition of these results across various experiments, conducted with different materials and under different conditions, indicates that these elements are likely products of the LENR process itself, suggesting that the mechanism at work may be more complex than simple fusion. By continuously dismissing these findings as contamination or experimental error, researchers risk overlooking critical data that could lead to a deeper understanding of nuclear processes at play in LENR. To move forward, it is essential to approach LENR with an open mind, acknowledging that fusion may not be the sole process occurring. Instead, a broader perspective is required, one that allows for the possibility of fission-like reactions, transmutations, or other novel nuclear processes that occur under low energy conditions. Only by considering all of the evidence, rather than dismissing inconvenient results, can the scientific community begin to unlock the true nature of LENR and its potential applications. Despite decades of effort, no theory has yet fully explained the LENR phenomenon in a way that enhances its reproducibility or robustness, nor has any explanation gained widespread acceptance beyond niche groups. This lack of consensus stems from the extraordinary nature of LENR, which contradicts conventional nuclear physics. Any valid theory must distinguish between LENR and other nuclear processes, such as hot fusion, which can sometimes occur simultaneously in similar environments. For instance, crack formation in deuterium-laden materials can produce transient high voltages, leading to fusion through hot fusion mechanisms and its characteristic energetic nuclear products, like neutron bursts. These bursts must be carefully evaluated to avoid conflating them with LENR. Theoretical approaches to LENR generally fall into two categories. The first assumes that LENR can occur spontaneously within a normal lattice or on the surface of unaltered materials when conditions such as deuterium concentration reach critical levels. This approach struggles to reconcile the rare and localized nature of LENR with a well-understood behavior of stable chemical systems. The second approach posits that LENR reactions require the formation of unique environments where nuclear reactions can occur. This perspective aligns with the observed rarity of LENR, as ordinary materials lack the necessary structural or energetic changes to support nuclear processes under normal conditions. Materials like palladium and nickel are stable under typical LENR experiment conditions and do not spontaneously develop the necessary properties for nuclear reactions. For LENR to occur, significant structural changes or external energy inputs must create an area with the right conditions for nuclear reactions to occur, while maintaining compatibility with thermodynamic laws. Any theory must account for this requirement and logically explain how LENR begins, how energy is dissipated without conventional radiation, and how fusion, fission, transmutation, and radiation products arise. The role of specific mechanisms in enabling low-energy nuclear reactions has been explored through various hypotheses. Metal atom vacancies. One proposed NAE involves vacancies in the palladium sublattice, where metal atoms are missing, creating spaces for deuterium to cluster and potentially fuse. Hagelstein and Chaudhary suggest that these vacancies can host more than two deuterons, leading to helium formation. However, this model faces significant challenges. Studies have shown that vacancies introduced by cold working palladium are eliminated when the material is heated to typical LENR operating temperatures, casting doubt on their persistence. Even with calculations showing up to 6 deuterons occupying a vacancy, the density is insufficient to overcome fusion barriers. Additionally, the required fusion conditions would produce detectable radiation, which is not observed. The predicted sensitivity of this mechanism to deuterium pressure does not align with experimental data. These shortcomings undermine the validity of this explanation. Role of neutrons. Neutron-based mechanisms eliminate the Coulomb barrier, but face significant theoretical and observational issues. Proposals include trapped neutrons or polyneutrons. These stable clusters of neutrons are hypothesized to be released under specific conditions. However, no direct evidence supports their existence in materials, and their absence in density measurements contradicts the theory. Electron-proton fusion. This mechanism requires energy levels far beyond what is achievable in chemical environments. The idea also violates thermodynamic principles by assuming energy can accumulate in electrons, which contradicts their constant rest mass. Virtual neutrons. Some researchers have speculated that if an electron could approach the nucleus close enough, it might effectively form a virtual neutron. This would allow an electron to shield a proton or deuteron sufficiently to facilitate its entry into the nucleus, bypassing the immense energy typically required to create a real neutron. Randall Mills proposed a theoretical framework suggesting that electrons could achieve this proximity by forming a novel state known as the hydrino, similar to Dufour et al. Introducing the concept of the hydrex, a stable structure composed of clustered electrons and photons that might lower the Coulomb barrier, enabling nuclear interactions. If neutrons were involved, their beta decay and gamma emissions would be detectable. Phonons and lattice vibrations. Phonons represent vibrational energy within a material, having been proposed as a way to bring nuclei into close proximity or accumulate energy for nuclear reactions. However, phonons cannot focus energy on specific nuclei without affecting the surrounding lattice, violating the second law of thermodynamics. While phonons could transfer energy released by nuclear reactions to the lattice, their proposed role in initiating these reactions conflicts with the observed material stability and chemical behavior. multibody fusion and Bose-Einstein condensates. Multibody fusion models and BEC structures suggest that clusters of deuterons or condensed quantum states might facilitate LENR. While appealing in their potential to distribute energy without radiation, BECs typically form near absolute zero, far from LENR operating conditions. Stabilizing such structures in practical LENR setups requires numerous assumptions, making the theory less plausible. Nuclear active environment. The nuclear active environment is a theoretical concept proposed by Edmund Storms to explain the conditions necessary for LENR to occur. NAEs are localized regions within a material, such as cracks, voids, nanotubes, that provide specific structural environments required for nuclear reactions. These environments are hypothesized to facilitate the interaction of hydrogen and deuterium isotopes, enabling fusion-like processes while avoiding the energetic radiation typical of conventional nuclear reactions. Tritium and helium formation are key signatures of the reactions occurring within NAEs, often accompanied by low-level X-ray emissions rather than high-energy particles. Strength of the NAE concept. The focus on localized environments such as cracks, voids, and nanoscale features aligns well with observations that LENR often occurs in highly specific regions of a material. The emphasis on material properties and surface interactions helps to explain why certain materials, like palladium and nickel, and specific treatments, hydrogen loading or thermal cycling, are more conducive to LENR. By proposing a mechanism that avoids the typical high energy outputs of conventional fusion, the NAE model provides a pathway to understanding low radiation LENR systems. Limitations of the NAE concept. The model is built around the production of tritium and helium, limiting its explanatory power for experiments that do not detect these byproducts or instead report fission-like products or isotopic transmutations. LENR experiments have been conducted across a wide variety of conditions, ranging from electrolytic cells to gas phase systems and plasma discharges, many of which do not easily fit the framework of NAEs. The NAE concept does not address why LENR results vary so significantly, even under seemingly similar conditions. Some experiments produce excess heat without nuclear products, while others show evidence of heavier elements breaking down or fusing. The NAE concept provides a solid foundation for understanding localized reaction sites, but it would benefit from being more inclusive of the full spectrum of LENR phenomena. This is a microcosm of the broader issue facing LENR as a field: the challenge of reconciling highly variable results with a unifying theoretical framework. The diversity in observed nuclear outputs, ranging from fusion-like helium production to fission-like fragmentation and transmutation, suggests that LENR may not be driven by a single mechanism. Instead, it could involve multiple overlapping processes, each influenced by specific materials, experimental setup, and conditions involved. To move forward, it's crucial for researchers to adopt an open approach, considering that localized environments might facilitate various nuclear processes beyond fusion. This openness is particularly important when exploring alternative frameworks for understanding LENR, such as the structured atom model. Unlike conventional theories rooted in quantum mechanics, SAM proposes a radically different view of atomic and nuclear structure, one that challenges many of the assumptions underlying traditional physics. While SAM offers intriguing possibilities for explaining LENR, embracing it requires a willingness to re-examine deeply ingrained beliefs about atomic behavior and nuclear reactions. By shifting focus away from the quantum mechanical paradigm, SAM introduces new ways of understanding how nuclei might interact, transmute, or fragment in the unique conditions present in LENR systems. For example, SAM could potentially provide insights into the observed isotopic shifts, fission-like products, and the apparent lack of high-energy radiation in LENR experiments, phenomena that remain difficult to reconcile within conventional frameworks. Engaging with models like SAM demands an open mind and a readiness to explore unfamiliar territory. However, the complexity and diversity of LENR results underscores the need for such bold, innovative thinking. By broadening our perspective and embracing alternative theories, we stand a better chance of uncovering the mechanisms driving LENR and unlocking its potential as a revolutionary energy source. As always, be brave, be curious. The truth is waiting for us. Until next time.